Gloria.
An extremely special program. Are we excited or are we excited? Okay, you can be quiet now. Because our very special star guest today is one of the best singer-songwriters of our time and quite simply one of the world's biggest selling artists. It is the one and only Neil Diamond!
My baby's crying on a Saturday night. She thinks that nothing's ever gonna go right. But she'll make it, and we'll make it. There's no way that I'm leaving the best part of me. You are the best part of me. The best that I am or ever will be. You, baby, you're the part that allows me to open my heart and let love inside. I want you to know what I've always known. You're the best part of me. Love isn't easy and it's not always kind. Sometimes you only have to make up your mind that you can make it, and you can make it. I know I made it by keeping the best part of me. And you are the best part of me. The best that I am or ever will be. You, baby, you're the part that allows me to open my heart and let love inside. I want you to know what I've always known. You're the best part of me. Baby's crying 'cause she can't run away. If she could, it wouldn't last for a day. And she knows it, and I know it. It just shows that she is the best part of me. It's true, baby, you're the best part of me. The best that I am or ever will be. You, baby, you're the part that allows me to open my heart and let love inside. I want you to know what I've always known. You're the best part of me. Yes, you are. You're the best part of me.
Great song. Come and have a seat.
Thank you, Dad.
I did assure the girls I would give you a kiss on all of their behalfs. That's why I made it lingering.
Well, I may have to go up there during the show.
Just may have to do it, Gloria.
Such a pretty song. Actually, when I was sitting in the audience, they were all singing along with the words, and even though that's quite a new one.
Well, they probably know the words better than I do. Yeah, wonderful. So they gave me this, you know, before the show. I didn't realize, but this is 25 years to the day that I played.
Of Woburn Abbey.
Woburn Abbey. It was one of the most wonderful venues and, you know, fabulous, gorgeous. It's a castle.
Yes,
and we did it in front of the home. And
in fact, if I remember correctly, you got to know the family very well, didn't you? Like, subsequently, you visited each other and one thing
and
another.
We've become very good friends, and I love the Tavistocks. And now Andrew Halland, who's the oldest son, has taken over. And it's an enormous job to run this place, but they do beautifully. And I stay up there occasionally. And we've become very good
friends. And on that particular night, 25 years ago, the weather was brilliant. It just couldn't have been better.
Unbelievable. Unbelievable. And we had it filmed for... we were going to do a television show. Bill Friedkin, the very well-known, respected Hollywood director, came in to do it. And he wanted me out to go out while there was still light, and I didn't realize it. I said, the audience is not ready to go out. And we had a big tiff backstage, and he left, you know. He abandoned the show, but he fortunately left the camera crew there, and so they filmed it anyway without the director.
Well, we should have a look at our audience, because the people responsible for giving you the T-shirt just before the program, there they are, looking resplendent. So listen, who's the spokesperson amongst all of you there?
I am.
You are. Okay, what's your name?
Evelyn.
Evelyn. So just tell me a bit about the history then of keeping together over the 25 years.
Well, we couldn't let today go without marking it in this way. It was just so coincidental. And then, I mean, since then, we've been getting together every year, every January, to celebrate Neil's birthday. We have quizzes, we watch videos, we have a disco in the evening. Totally your music, of course.
Oh, Neil music only, yeah, of course. Do you remember of that particular night, seeing it's such a, you know, 25th anniversary? Yes?
Yes.
Yeah,
carry on.
Yeah, exactly.
It was wonderful.
Absolutely.
Wonderful experience. We'd love to have it again.
It was our first day of summer that particular year. It had been raining right up until the 2nd of July. And the day dawned and the skies were blue.
And Neil had been praying a lot.
Oh, I was. I was. And it was an exquisite day, and it was a great... great memory for me. I still remember so many things about it. It's hard to believe it's 25 years, yes. But we had a bagpipe band come in. Do you remember that?
Yes, absolutely.
Before the show. Oh, God, we did the show, and I was wearing a red shirt.
Blue
and
shirt.
I know.
It changed.
I guess the memory is mine is not. Yes, I remember it well.
This week, though, you're going to be outdoors again because you're opening the tour in
Dublin,
where they normally play the rugby at Lansdowne.
Exactly, and I hope they don't expect me to play rugby there because I'm not ready for it. But yes, we'll be playing at Lansdowne in Dublin, and it'll be outdoors, and you know, we'll keep our fingers crossed.
I want to tell you that the Irish rain is very soft. It's very good for your complexion as well, so I wouldn't worry about it really.
Okay.
The nice thing about the Irish people, so used to the rain anywhere, they'll be out there. It won't matter what kind of weather it is.
Well, we'll do the show, yeah. No question about it.
Now, how do you psych up for a tour? Because obviously you've done a few legs of it in America,
yes.
And now you're here for the British and Irish section.
Yes. Well, I'm not sure that you really have to psych up. I mean, I know that I have to do a certain number of performances and that the audience will be there and anticipating the shows. And it's a show that I'm very, very happy with. I finally have a string section and horns and singers and in addition to my band. So it's something that I've always wanted to do. And so we're bringing it here, you know, to England, to Ireland, to Scotland. And just to show it off, to show off our wares and to have a good time. And I'm excited about it. I don't have to do anything artificial to...
You don't have to get yourself, like, super fit or anything to be on the road so much.
Well, it's helpful to be fit, and I've been working out. But I always put that off. I always say, you know, 2 months before I go, I'm going to start working out and doing sit-ups. And then I said, no, I don't really need 2 months. I think maybe a month will do it, you know. And, And then it comes down to the last 3 days, and I say, oh, I got to do something here, you know.
Well, we should say that that song which you sang at the top, although it comes from three-chord opera and therefore relatively new song,
yes.
It's also on the new album of Essential Neil Diamond,
yes.
38 tracks.
Thank
what
you.
Did you have to leave off is the question.
Realistically, we did have to leave off quite a number of songs because the record company said, well, you know, they were not happy with putting 38 tracks on, and they wanted 30 to begin with. And I said, we can't. If it's called the Essential Neil Diamond, it's got to have lots of things that are required. And, well, we left a number of songs off, but they can be found in other albums.
So did you do it chronologically? I mean, literally starting with the earlier material?
I think that's probably how we did it. I'd have to look at the side order.
Mm.
But also the songs have to work in sequence on the particular disc that they're on. So I think we probably adjusted some, and you know.
Excellent. The one thing that I always notice about you in terms, because I saw you once doing a live show in America for about 3 hours, you know, taking in live phone calls and so on. It is clear that you love responding to the audience, and you know, you come alive on the stage. And some people sometimes say that you're almost like two people because you're quite private in your own life. You know, and like, do you become a different person, do you feel, once you walk out?
Yes, you know, it's interesting to me too, because I'm not an extroverted personality usually. I'm not one of these people that...
You're not Graham Norton, in other words.
I'm not... Well, he was, you know, thank goodness he was very nice to me.
Now, listen, that guy that you kissed in the audience, he's been writing to you ever since.
Well, they sent me tapes of that show to the States and said, you should look at this before you do it, Neil, because you've committed to it, but you should just have an idea of what you're getting yourself in for. And I thought, wow, why do we do this? And I was very nervous about it, but he was a real gentleman.
You remained intact, and that's the main thing.
I survived it. And,
anyway, you were saying about, you know, you're not that extroverted person in your real life.
Not really. I'm kind of quiet. I prefer it that way. It's always been my nature. And but when you get in front of an audience, it's, you know, it just lifts you up. It changes you, and you're allowed to become, you know, the extroverted person that you're not, and I do, and I have a lot of fun with the audience, and I'm basically there to have a good time.
Because originally, you didn't really anticipate that you were going to be the performer. You were going to be a songwriter, and that was it.
Hopefully, you know, that's what I hoped for, just to be able to write songs and to make a living, you know, didn't have to be much, and to write songs for my life, and this was my dream, and my dream came true, really, because that's what I'm doing, but... I'm doing a great deal of the writing for myself, which is even better, you know. I don't have to, you know, please anybody else, really. It's me, and I write the things that I can do well, hopefully, and that make me happy.
Did you just get to a point where you just thought, well, I'm not going to do this lark of writing for everybody else. I want to sing the songs.
Well, I was a pretty consistent failure at writing for other people. I tried it for about 8 years. In Tin Pan Alley in New York City. I barely got by. I was able to get advances for songs and just enough to, you know, to pay for lunch, barely. Just fortunately, and I'd signed some recording contracts because I sang all my demonstration records, and occasionally someone would pick up on it and say, you know, I like your voice and why don't you sing for us? But it was the songwriting that I focused on, and after about 8 years, I got my break, you know, found a couple of producers that were very interested in recording me, and they were top people. That was Jeff Barry and Ellie Greenwich, and wonderful, talented people. And that was the beginning of my career. We went in, recorded Solitary Man and Cherry Cherry and one other song, and, you know, I was suddenly an artist.
And do you feel that you're still as competitive today, still as driven as you were in those early days when you started making the hits for yourself?
I do think I'm driven to a certain degree. I'm not sure why. I do want the music to be heard, so that's the bottom line. It's a tremendous amount of work to write it and to do it well. It requires a great deal of love and just concentration and time. So you want the music to get out there and to be heard by people, and in order to do that, you've got to do your interviews and your radio interviews and your news interviews. And every once in a while, I'm fortunate enough to have a friend like you who'll invite me on and
thank you. Let me it's such a hard job, really. I know. I have to think twice and three times about it every time as to whether I'm going to ask you or not.
Well, but
well, tell you what's interesting about your music, though. Every so often, a hit will take on a new lease of life. Although it's been a hit, you know, for many, many years, it's
yes.
like America.
Yes.
Since September the 11th, America has become like an anthem. So I'm going
very
to
much.
Look at an extract from a concert, I believe it was in New York, about a month after the very, very serious event.
Right.
So we'll have a look at it first.
Got a dream to take them there. They come to America. Got a dream they come to share. They come to America. Stand up for America. Stand up for America. Stand up for America. Stand up for America.
The emotion of being a New Yorker, first and foremost, yourself, and you
yes.
were in New York, weren't you, when it happened?
Actually, we were there and played Madison Square Garden about 4 weeks after this
afterwards.
Tragedy in New York, and the city was still shaken by this, and I didn't know if anyone would show up. People were afraid to gather together in large groups. Nobody really knew how to handle themselves and to protect themselves in this kind of situation. But amazingly, everybody showed. The Madison Square Garden was packed, and it was a very moving and memorable show for me, particularly doing that song for the audience. It was a time for goosebumps, if there ever was one.
So, I mean, originally, when you wrote the song, it was sheer emotion anyway, because it was tying
yes.
in with your grandparents being immigrants to America.
Very much so. It was written for the Jazz Singer film, and it was kind of the story of my grandparents and immigrants all over the world who identify with the song and have told me that. And it tells their story. But it's taken on a new meaning and a new importance in the States, and we'll do it in England as well and all over, wherever.
And I should imagine a great song to sing because it's
wonderful.
Such an emotional song.
Wonderful.
So. Excellent.
Very, very.
Now, do you think you can all stay there till after the break? Will you be able to stand the pace? I want to tell you that I have Neil glued to the seat now, so there's no chance of him getting out, because Neil is going to stay with us right through to the end of the programme with some more live music as well. However, the important thing is that the phone lines are open as of this minute, so it's your chance to pick up the telephone and talk to Neil direct. He can be yours for the price of a call. As always, the number is 020-769-15000, and we're going to be taking your calls right after the break. But will you thank Neil Diamond? That was lovely. That was lovely. Such good fun. We'll see you right after the break. Now, if you've just joined us, our very special guest today is a singer-songwriter who, at the last count, had sold an incredible 115 million albums. Is it more than that now, do you think?
Well, if people watch the show, maybe it's 115,230,000.
It is Neil Diamond. Now, many of his fans will remember this early hit from 1966, so watch this. Today, yes. Today, yes. Today, yes. Today. Oh, well, it was was so good we did it twice. We loved it so much the first time around. Actually, what I wanted to play was Cherry Cherry. Do you have it? Do you like Cherry Cherry? Yeah, I really like it. So the thing is, girls, if I keep talking long enough, there's a little man behind the scenes here with a machine. Actually, you could tell me about... Are you ready yet? Are you ready? Play it, yes!
She does. She's gonna show me tonight, yeah. She got the way to move me, Jeffrey.
Instead of that V2 clip going adrift.
I love to hear when the audience sings. That's great.
It's terrific. What was the story behind Cherry Cherry?
No story. I could make one up, though. Just a song. I was sitting around the record label and fooling with a guitar figure that I had, and I played it for Jeff Barry, and he liked it a lot. It was that da dun 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 dun. And he said, you got to finish it. So I went home and I finished it and became Cherry Cherry ultimately. And he's wonderful.
Exactly. And of course, one of the earlier hits. Yeah. Well, I want to tell you, Neil, I know you went to Wimbledon the other day for the first time, didn't you? Did you have a good time?
Oh, it was great. It was a ball because we've just seen it on television for years and years and since I was a little boy. So just to be there and we watched. Tim Henman play, and of course I chewed all my nails off. He doesn't ever win easy. This poor guy. You know, once he'd be nice for him to win a match very quickly and easily, but he won it, and you know I was happy as can be. And
well, I was there yesterday. I think I aged 10 years just sort of watching him. But anyway, got there in the end. The reason I mentioned Wimbledon is the fact that this audience have been camping out like Wimbledon all night just to be here, which is fantastic. So I'm going to take some questions from the audience. So who would like to go first? Okay, what's your name?
Joan.
Well, Joan, Neil is all yours.
Neil. I've lost my voice now. Neil, if you could choose anyone in the world, dead or alive, to have a one-to-one chat with, who would it be?
Well, first I'd say I'd prefer they be alive. You know, you can get a conversation going. It's so hard the other way. You know. I don't know. Let's see. Who would you think?
Anybody in politics that you really admire over the years?
No, in politics. I don't like to talk to those people because you can never get a real conversation going.
Any music people? Any writers?
Somebody in the music business, maybe.
Who?
Somebody in the music business, maybe.
You know, I don't care for those people.
You don't.
I would love to have a conversation with Marilyn Monroe.
Oh, yeah.
You know, she, I think, would be a very interesting person to talk to. She was such a sensitive person, and I think beneath that facade of the sexy woman and the Hollywood star, I think she must have been a very interesting person, and I think if I had anybody, it would be her, I think.
Well, Einstein liked her, didn't he?
Did
he? Yes, he did.
Really well.
Anyway, there we go.
What's not to like? Yeah.
Okay, next question.
Hi, Neil. Welcome to the UK. It's great to have you back.
Oh, it's great to be here.
Are you Alison?
Hi, Neil. Is there anybody, past or present, or a band that you would like to work with in the future?
Let's see, past or present, living, hopefully.
It makes it easier, I think.
Someone I'd like to work with, I think Marilyn Monroe. Yeah, you know, as long as you're, you know, we've already had a conversation with her. I know the woman a little bit.
So more social than business, then, maybe.
She sings. Who I'd like to work with? You know, it'd be wonderful to have worked with the Beatles, probably the greatest musical group of our time.
Would you like to have been in the original lineup and at the very beginning of all of that?
You know, I think they had a very difficult time because they were in the public's by in such a way that, you know, beyond what any other performer or celebrity has experienced, I don't think I'd want to go through that. I'm very happy doing my little thing, having a wonderful audience that's here and, you know, happy to see me, and without the craziness that the Beatles had to go through, sure. Where every moment of their lives was looked at under a microscope. It must have been very difficult. And to be creative and to make wonderful music at the same time, it's no wonder, really, that they only worked for a limited period of time, because you can only handle that for just so long.
Mind you, I've seen women running after you trying to tear your clothes off, so don't tell me that you're definitely not. All right, we're going to take a phone call now. Ruth Crockett is on the line from Lichfield. Hi, Ruth.
Hello.
Hi,
hello,
nice to have you with us. It's your line to Neil.
Thank you. Hello, Neil.
Hi, Ruth.
Hello. I'd like to thank you for all the music. You've enriched a lot of people's lives over 30 years, mine, because I'm a little old. I heard you first, I would say, at the beginning of the 70s, when we had some exchange USAF people, because my husband was in the Air Force. The other question I'd like to ask is, what music do you listen, dance to? What gets you on the floor and moving?
Oh, what gets you moving, Neil? Ooh,
what gets me
question,
moving?
Good question, Ruth.
Well,
you know, I still love the old Motown records, the Four Tops and Mary Wells and Supremes and the Miracles and, you know, all of those wonderful groups that...
You've got quite good taste, too.
Well,
and I like the new one that you just sang at the beginning of the show.
Oh, thank you very much.
It's as good as some of the way past ones.
Thank you so
much.
Yeah,
that's great.
Thank you.
Actually, Ruth, you raised a very interesting question, because to be able to write good songs and memorable songs over a long period of time, as you have, Neil, not that I'm saying you're that old, but you know what I mean.
Thank you.
I mean, since the 60s, you know, the longevity is fantastic. So is your yardstick, do you think, today, just as it was at the beginning?
Well, it's pretty much the same goal, and that's to try and write something beautiful. Just a beautiful piece of music with beautiful words, somehow to express the inner self, my inner self. And because we're all together in this crazy life that we live, something that will touch everybody else as well. Maybe not everybody, but a lot of people are moved by the music, and this is always very encouraging for me to see.
So you like to make it quite universal, so that it appeals to people the world over?
It just seems that way. It just happens. It's not something I try for. I try to make something that I'm happy with, and it seems that if I'm happy with it and it moves me, then people out there will identify with it, and thank goodness.
We take another call from Aylesbury. It's Sandy Breen. Good afternoon, Sandy, and it's your line straight through to Neil.
Good afternoon, Neil.
Hi, Sandy.
Lovely to see you in the country again.
I'm not making
a concert this time. It's the first time I'm missing your concert.
Oh, well, why are you missing it? Where are you? And why
I'm Aylesbury in Buckinghamshire. I'm out of work at the moment, Neil. I'm a little bit short on the cash.
And the old Reddies.
Well, what city are you near that we're playing, and I'll arrange for tickets for you.
London would be obviously suitable for you, Sandy.
Yeah, London would be brilliant.
Okay, we'll hold two tickets for you then, Sandy.
Oh, you just made the second dream come true.
So, Sandy, did you say that you just lost your job?
I used to work with children in care, and I got assaulted quite badly, and I haven't been able to go back to it since 1997. Uh-huh. I've tried something else, but it hasn't worked out.
Well, this is going to make your day, isn't it? Being able to go to the concert.
Gloria, this is making my day. I've been waiting for you to come on since you met you in America. I'm so jealous.
Well, there you go. I did have a good time over there when I went to the
United. We did.
I shared his makeup artist, and she was very
yes.
Oh, gosh. I thought you were making me worse. You know, my friends are probably all... They're all taping all this, you know, Neil.
Okay,
I bore them all to death with you. I really do.
Well, I'll tell you what, Sandy. I'm going to say your name again, just in case your friend didn't hear it the first time around. It is Sandy Breen from Aylesbury. Who's been personally invited to Neil Diamond's concert by Neil Diamond.
Yes.
How good is that? Anyway, Sandy, it was worth your while ringing in today, and thank you very much indeed for joining us. Have a lovely time.
Thank you. Anyway, I have a question for you, Neil.
Oh, dear, extra bonus. Okay. What's the quick question, then?
Following the success of Elvis's remix, would you appreciate or would you be annoyed if people started remixing and messing with your music or
like made them all disco fashion? You mean, Sandy?
Well, I wouldn't like it personally, but what does Neil think? Red Red Wine, I think they didn't do such a bad job on it, whoever they were. Not as good as his, but not too bad.
I think they did a beautiful job on it because they made something entirely different out of it. But no, I'll have to listen to the Elvis remix. I've heard about it, and I really haven't heard it. I'd prefer that they not mess with it too much while I'm alive.
Yeah. You know,
after I'm gone.
When you're gone, Neil.
After I'm gone, they can do whatever they like as long as people enjoy it. And
Neil, my children, my grandchildren love your music as it is. It's going on to the third generation in this family.
Beautiful.
And rightly so, Sandy. Thank you very much indeed, and have a wonderful time at the concert.
Thank you.
Bye-bye. That's a very lucky call.
Wonderful.
And another one from Southampton. It's Pauline Arthurs. Hi, Pauline.
Hello.
Hello, it's your line to Neil Diamond.
And I'm really talking to Neil Diamond.
I'm afraid you are, Pauline.
Oh, my God.
It's just the two of us, and we're together alone here now. So let's get down to it.
Right, I don't want to waste your time. I will be seeing you in Birmingham, 4 rows from the front.
Ooh.
There.
That's my favorite row. I always pick out a girl from the 4th row.
Yes, please.
Now, Pauline, don't go all of a quiver on me just yet.
You can't help it, Gloria.
I know. Do you have a quick question?
Yes, dear. Yes, dear.
Okay.
My love is motorbikes, and I know Neil loves motorbikes.
I adore them.
But I've never known. I've seen pictures of him when he's gone touring with his friends now. But what bikes has he got, and how many has he got?
I have 3 motorcycles. They're all Harley Davidsons. One was given to me, and it's my very favorite. It was given to me by my band and my crew and the whole organization that tours with me. And it was, you know, I was shocked when I got it. It's a marvelous gift, and that's my favorite. And when I do go out now, and I do go out occasionally, I'll get on that motorcycle and ride it around L.A. But I haven't taken any long trips in quite a while. Maybe it's time to get back to that.
Yeah, you used to do that, didn't you? A bit of anonymity, get the old crash helmet on.
Oh, yes, it's wonderful. Nobody recognizes you. You're part of, you know, the scenery. And it's just a great experience, especially in the States, because there's so much to see. There really are so many beautiful areas to go to. We went up to Alaska and through the Rocky Mountains and through deserts and Death Valley, which is an interesting thing to do in the summer because it's 115 degrees.
Hot.
And all German tourists. I don't know those. Somebody is telling those German people the wrong thing. I think that they have feelings since the war. And they say, go to Death Valley in the summer. It's the perfect time. And they're, you know, frying there.
And just quickly to say as well, by the way, Pauline, thank you very much indeed. I'm going to hold this steady.
Lovely.
Because this one was given to you, wasn't it, by a fan?
By these people right here.
Yeah, fantastic. With a little Harley thing on the top. But that's fantastic. It's very good. Anyway, we'll try and come back and take a few more of the audience questions. But at this stage, we've got a great competition because I know that one, actually, lucky viewer has already had her tickets given to her by Neil. But we've got another pair of tickets to win. Now, it is for Neil's final
concert. Those are the ones I just gave away, Gloria.
Oh, what? Forget the competition, okay?
Okay. Well, we'll find some other seats.
Squeeze another pair of tickets.
May have to be on stage.
Exactly. 28th of July is the day. It's a Sunday, if I remember correctly, and it is at Earl's Court. Earl's Court Arena?
Yes, it is, in London.
We've also got a signed CD as well of the latest. It's all the latest stuff. Now, all you have to do is to answer this really difficult question. I don't think even Neil could answer this. Which of these was a hit for Neil Diamond in 1966? Was it A, Apple Blossom Time? Was it B, Cherry Cherry? Or was it C, Strawberry Fields? Now, that requires a lot of thinking, so I just wish you good luck for the competition. Now, as Neil is going to be in Ireland on the 4th of July, he'll be getting ready, of course, to kick off his tour on the 5th. We're going to be celebrating Independence Day just a day or two earlier because Paul Bloxham is going to be in the kitchen. Mm. So will you thank Neil Diamond? And don't go away, because we'll see you after the break. Thank you, Neil. to a lot of fun here in the house. And in the kitchen today, one of the world's most expensive chefs. It's cost us a fortune to get him here. It is Neil Diamond cooking away. And we're obviously going to be, yes.
It's good.
We're going to be celebrating American Independence Day for the 4th of July with American cooking. Unfortunately, yes. To take on the cooking, we're aided and abetted by Paul Bloxham. Glad you're here. Because actually, Neil, I gather you do not cook.
I don't cook at all, but I eat wonderfully. I'm a very appreciative audience.
A little dicky bird did tell me that you've got a good affiliation with microwaves or something like that.
Microwaves, that's about it. That's as far as I go.
Is it true that you buy coffee the night before so you can zap it in the microwave the next day?
Yes.
You do not.
I do.
That
I
is
do.
Terrible.
Well, we have to get through somehow, but this is a brilliant man, and I want to. We're going to have some of this after the show, yes?
Oh, definitely, definitely.
Okay.
So, what are you going to cook? Is this typical of what Americans would have on Independence Day?
Well, sort of, yeah. Gumbos in different regions. Caesar salad is the classic. I mean, from Tijuana, pre-Prohibition days, you know, they used to make this salad to go over the border to have a drink. That's what it was, I think.
That's right.
That's probably right. At Caesar's Palace with Caesar Cardini, and Caesar's salad. Is a beautiful, beautiful, and that's what I'm going to start off with.
Beautiful.
And if you could keep it on this roof
yes,
for me, don't let him burn too much.
Keep on working now. Don't slack.
Okay. Well, sorry.
What we've got here, we've got some mustard, some sourdough. Sourdough's big in the States. Sourdough bread,
yes.
Really earthy bread, not made with yeast, made with fermented potato to prove it. We've got some anchovies, garlic, lemon, and some croutons. And this is the key: cos lettuce or romaine, as you call it in.
Exactly.
And that's the key. So what we're going to do is...
I must say, a good Caesar salad is just the best, isn't it?
Well, it should be made last minute. You can't let it... So all you need for the dressing is a teaspoon of mustard. Just a little bit more than that. That's enough. A good squeeze of lemon. OK.
All your friends, Neil, are going to be
and
so
then we
impressed.
Got some
You'll
anchovies.
Be making them Caesar salad from here on in.
About four anchovies, a couple of bits of garlic. OK, I'm going to squeeze a bit more lemon because you don't need any vinegar in this. This is the acidity to give it a bit
and
of
this
a...
This is called watch the suede shirt, OK?
Okay.
That's okay.
Oh, you're okay in there. That's good. A good slug of olive oil, like so. And the key to this one is a little bit of the old English Worcestershire sauce. Uh-huh. And just a nice little zing in there. Okay. And this is an American recipe. And all you do with that is...
Whoosh it up.
And that's it. And that's your dressing. So we've got that done. We'll get rid of this here. And I'll take back the croutons and the parmesan. And this is how simple it is to put together. You take a lettuce, a romaine lettuce, you don't cut it, you rip it, never use a knife.
Oh.
And all you do is just break the leaves up like so.
I love that.
And we're in there. Nice croutons. They've been baked in the oven for about 5 minutes.
Big croutons. Ooh.
Big croutons. Got to be big. What they say, and I was told in America, big is beautiful, you know. And another thing was boys were the biggest toys, you know. So,
what are you talking about now?
Oh, sorry, yes. Well, Neil agreed
with me behind there, yes.
And all you do is put it in like that, take a couple of spoons, dress it like so, very lightly, and this has got to be served right away.
Do you put any chopped egg or anything in yours?
No chopped egg or anything like that. All you're going to do afterwards, let me take a nice bowl and turn that into a nice bowl like so. Look at that. How simple.
No anchovies?
Anchovies are in the dressing.
Oh, in the dressing.
All you need is just a good little bit. A freshly grated parmesan, and that is the key. Mm. And there we go, Caesar salad, that's number
Excellent.
One.
I like the Caesar salad,
Beautiful.
Great. Shall we keep that for afterwards?
Well, now we've...
Would you like that?
Yes, I'd love to have the taste of that.
Poor man hasn't eaten for a week.
Well, close.
Do you want to taste this now?
Yeah, well, yes, sure.
Why not? There you
go.
Gloria, why don't you
take
a little bit?
Now, what we've got here, over here, is, while you're tasting that, is chicken. And what we've got here...
No?
Go
on. My mouth is big, but maybe not just quite that big.
Okay.
Good dressing.
Is that a nice dressing?
But lovely.
That's
I have been fed by Neil Diamond. I want you to know that. Yeah. That's okay.
Now, I know as well, Neil, that you like chicken. You go to Spargo's.
Yes, I
four,
do.
That's famous right. in California for roast chicken. Now, exactly. We've got another dish here, which is southern fried chicken. And I'm just going to quickly talk you through this. The key to good southern fried chicken is flour that's seasoned. And in there we've got, and I need a little reminder here because there's lots of it, peppercorns, allspice, and thyme, dried thyme. With flour, you just dress the outside of the chicken with the flour.
And actually, I noticed that you've taken the skin off, which
Take
is a
the
good
skin
idea.
Off,
yeah.
And it keeps it crispy because that fat doesn't draw back into it. Into a bit of egg, just two beaten eggs, like so. Nice and easy. And into some breadcrumbs. Now, there's two schools of thought here. You can have chicken fried steaks and things like that where they draw it.
I've tried that.
And what they'll do, instead of putting it into the breadcrumbs, they'll draw it back through the flour. Like the Colonel's recipe.
Okay.
What do you mean, like, do it twice?
Do it twice, yeah, without the breadcrumbs.
Ah, that's a secret.
All you do with that, into a fryer, like so, and that, at 150 degrees, it's quite important, this is a bone in there, for about 10 to 15 minutes. nice and relaxed. And with that, you would serve corn pancakes. We've got the traditional corn pancakes and a nice salsa. And look at this, a nice fresh salsa. And there you go. That is
what did you put in your salsa?
And that's just cucumber, onions, fresh coriander, tomatoes, olive oil, little lemon juice.
How's the season going down, Neil?
Oh, good. It's wonderful. Mm-hmm.
Excellent. Well, excellent. Now we're going to get on to really what I think
the gumbo.
The gumbo. Oh, gumbo yaya.
You're going to New Orleans, aren't you, fairly soon?
Yes, we're playing New Orleans in the fall, and this is their specialty down in Louisiana.
In Louisiana. Well, there's loads of different schools of thought with this as well, but I'm going to go through my ingredients for this one.
And, of course, Neil did a very good job of studying all
the
sauce.
And this is the key to it. This here I've got... What I've done is I've cooked this chicken off in about half a cup of oil. You need plenty of oil for this. And I've just dressed it like this in a little bit of seasoned flour. And all you do with that after, take the chicken out and then put another cup of oil in there and a cup of flour. And this is called the roux. And this, you need to burn it like this. And this is the chocolatiness, and this creates the richness.
Beautiful.
As you know, the richness. And the darker the roux, the better the gumbo, they say.
I also want you to know that when we burn things in the kitchen, we call it caramelizing. It's just a nicer phrase
for
these days.
Well, I'll be an expert at that.
Another thing with gumbos is they use the trinity, what they call their trinity of vegetables. And that is peppers, celery and onions. So most dishes, like jambalaya and things like that, they use what they call the holy trinity of vegetables.
So just do that again.
And we've got celery, peppers and onions.
Right, OK.
OK? And when that roux's cooked to that stage, all you do with that is pop all these ingredients in, it'll sizzle away. OK, give that a little stir. Oh, look at that, you can smell
them. So already you're off to a good start there.
Yeah.
Great.
Oh, Lord.
OK, and then what you're going to add to that then, after that, is bay leaves and thyme, pepper, cayenne pepper, and salt.
Hot.
You need a bit of hot, don't you?
Oh, that's hot. Yes, that's good.
And, that's look at those, all those flavours marrying in like that. It really looks good. And then we're going to carry on with the other ingredients, which is 2 quarts, which is about 2 litres. That's the American terminology. Quarts, you use quarts of chicken stock. Get that in there like that.
Always chicken stock.
Well, chicken stock or vegetable stock, whatever, fish stock, whatever you want. Mm-hmm. And then these lovely ingredients. So we've got the chicken. Get that in there like so. And wheel sausage, which is smoky sausage, any sausage to do.
We're doing all right.
That goes in there.
Oh, this is exquisite.
And a little bit of garlic. We're just going to pop that
in. As a point of interest, just while you're stirring all of that in, when you're out on tour, and I know that you've got a lot of very loyal band members and singers and so on, do you all eat together after the show? Do you...
We actually eat together before the show, but we don't have anything like this. I would love to have you come with us, Paul.
Oh,
on tour.
That's another offer. That gets cooking now for an hour and a half, nice and slowly, okay? And that's what you get afterwards. And what I've got to say, the last 15 minutes, we've got these mud crabs. You call them mud crabs?
Yes.
Look at these here. They're from their freshwater crayfish.
Mm-hmm. So do you get a lot of meat in those?
There is a lot of meat. They're like a langoustine. Mm-hmm. And what you do with these, just put them in for the last, drop them in for the last 15 minutes of cooking, and then you get the gumbo, like so. And that is the gumbo. I know you're going to serve you some of that.
Oh, absolutely.
What are you putting in that?
Just a little bit of parsley there.
This is
all I'm going to do is just go through. This is
Neil's not going to be parted from his Caesar salad.
You'd like a good cheesecake.
Oh, I love cheesecake.
Well, baked cheesecake is the New York speciality at the end of the day, isn't it? I'm just going to run through the ingredients. For the biscuit base here, we've got some chocolate cookies. Mm-hmm. I like chocolate cookies because the chocolate melts and solidifies it. A little bit of allspice and some butter crushed up on the stove, and then you just pop it in there as your base.
Oh, I see.
Okay. And after the base, so you've got that nice little bit.
Put it
in the fridge.
That give a nice crunchy
base? Nice crunchy chocolatey base.
Okay.
All you do with that then is 1/2 kilo of cream cheese, 4 eggs, 150 grams of sugar, a little of orange juice, and some vanilla. Mix that all together. And my trick with this is leave the eggs and the cream out in the fridge for about an hour, and it works a lot better.
What's that? Just makes it all softer.
And it just makes it work a lot. It doesn't split. Pop it in there, in the oven, 40 minutes. Wow, you have a cheesecake like this to die for.
So I mean, now, Neil, are you going to taste the gumbo first?
No, I'm
going to
taste everything.
Whatever
Paul will let me taste, I'm going
to
taste.
Now, you're likely then to have a nice sort of 4th of July celebration in Dublin? Because
Independence Day. Right. We're going to celebrate 4th of July in Dublin and...
It'll be done with a lot of Irish stew and Guinness.
That's fine. That's fine.
If you could just have a little.
So the American food will change. Ooh, that looks gorgeous.
Word. And I like rice in it too. Just... A tad of rice.
Excuse me, you tell him.
I'm sorry.
I missed out on the rice.
I'm sorry.
If you're going to go out on tour with the Neil Diamond crew, you've got to learn how to really
you
serve it up.
You have to have a little rice, and I'll give it a taste. And
And that's power-packed as well with that rice. Plenty of protein and energy in there. How's that?
Are you married?
Paul, I am just. Thank you very much. He already got married 2 weeks ago.
Oh, well.
You just missed out there.
I'm sorry, boy. You'd make somebody a great wife. Extraordinary. Thank you.
Paul, thank you very much.
My pleasure.
And thanks to Leo.
Thank you so much.
You can keep on eating.
Wow. I'm going to do that.
Now, before we go to the break, I just want to remind you yet again that Neil has very kindly given us a pair of tickets to his last concert in London and a signed CD to give away. All you have to do is to phone the competition hotline on this number, 0900 111 4411. I gave you the choice of the hits from 1966 earlier on. So Neil's going to be back after the break for some more chat, and he's going to be doing what he does best. He's going to be performing live right here in the house. So stay with us for more of this. We don't sing and dance and care. As long as I can have you here with me, I'd much rather be there in Bridget's bed. And honey, sweet, you ain't nothing but still a better treat. And if you caught me, I'd like to say, I'm sure you'd want to know this. The gumbo's all been finished now. Neil had all of that.
Oh,
he had all the Caesar salad. He's had all the cheesecake. So there's nothing less for any of us. So you enjoyed it, didn't you? All that tasting.
Oh, wonderful. And I'm still, because of the pepper. What was it, chili?
I think it, celery and peppers.
Chili, lots of peppers in there. So it's raised my temperature up here.
Oh, dear, and I thought it was me. We've had so many questions, of course, come pouring in, and we can only take a representative cross-section, but an awful lot of people have asked about collaboration, you know, and the fact that you, of course, would have to do You Don't Bring Me Flowers every night on stage, and you have a lovely singer who tours around
Wonderful.
With you. What was the origin of getting together with Barbra Streisand for that?
Well, you know, that has an interesting story, because the song was written specifically for a television show. I believe it was called All That Glitters. And it was a television show in the States that was to come out, and the roles of the men and women were reversed. So the secretaries in the office were men, and the executives were all women, and all the roles were reversed. And it was kind of an interesting premise. And the producer of the show, Norman Lear, asked if I would write a song for it, and what would I write? And I thought, well, it would be interesting to write a torch song for a man about how you've treated me so bad, and you know, the kind of song a woman would sing. And he put me together with the Bergmans, who I was thrilled to work with, and we came up with You Don't Bring Me Flowers for the television show. It was to last exactly 1 minute, and we did it, and we were pleased with the song, but we ran into a little conflict with the producer about, you know, who the song belonged to, and I don't like to give up the ownership of my music anymore. So I said, no.
Not easily, anyway.
I'd rather you not use it if you're gonna take the ownership from me. So we kept it, and the Bergmans and I sat down and wrote the rest of the song. We had the first minute, and now we wanted to write the and complete the song, which we did, and I recorded it and was very happy and very pleased with it. It was kind of an unusual song to throw on an album, but that was it. And Barbra Streisand heard it, and she thought, this is really one of your best songs. And she went in and recorded it herself. And interestingly enough, she recorded the same, excuse me, that gumbo is still...
still there.
The same key as I did it, and she used the same arranger as I did, and so it was very, very similar, the record. And when her record came out, disc jockeys in the States realized that the records were very similar, and they started to intercut the two. Barbra would sing a line, I would sing a line, she would, and back and forth. And we got some copies, and they started to get requests all over the country for people to play it. We got the copies, we liked what we heard, we went in and did it, and the duet became you know, an enormous success.
Legendary. It's probably one of the best-known duets, actually, of all time.
Well.
And what do you call the lovely girl who sings it in your concerts?
That's Linda Prez, and she's, you know, a marvelous, marvelous singer. I'm happy to do it with her.
Well, I really, really hope that you have a wonderful tour. I'd like to thank you so much for coming to see us again.
Thank you, Gloria.
It's always such a treat. And the only question I have left now is what you're going to sing right at the end of the program, right now.
Well, you know, I have no choice. I think Sweet Caroline is the only thing that I...
That'll do. Neil Diamond, thank you very much. Good. Thank you.
Where it began, I can't begin to know him, but then I know that it's growing strong. Well rehearsed, was in the spring. Spring became the summer. Who'd have believed you'd all come along? Oh Lord, hands, touching hands, you got it, reaching out, touching me, touching you, come on, we'll do it together now. Sweet Caroline, good times never seem so good. Look at the night, and it don't seem so lonely. We fill it up with only two. And when I heard, I'm getting a little seasick here, hurting runs off my shoulders. How can I hurt when I'm holding you? All right, here we go. No way. Warm. Touching warm. Reaching out. Touching me. Touching you. Here we go. Sweet Caroline. Good times now. Seems so good.
So good, so good, so good.
Yeah, I've been inclined to believe they never would. Whoa, no, no. All right. So good,
so good, so good, so good.
I've been inclined,
whoa, whoa, whoa,
to believe they never would. Here we go, last line. Sweet Caroline.